I'm very happy to introduce Therese, our next speaker, for the final talk of today. And maybe just to have the bow to the beginning talk. So we also met at the MCG Tagung in Hamburg. And Therese is doing lovely stuff with the Science Talenter, giving really nice course for mathematically gifted students. But today we will hear a little bit more about the mathematics competition and also about the topic we just had, so more about the connection to school mathematics. So thank you very much that you are here, and the stage is yours.
Yes, thank you. And I'd like to say thank you as well, because Denmark is a small country and we're not that many people doing mathematics, especially for gifted children. So I have an opportunity to hear about the experience of others. So thank you. And well, then let's start out. The subject is school math versus competition math. And I'll go through this first using a bit of time to explain how I came to think about the subject and what I did to find out about it. And what I did was mostly ask the kids, why are these two sorts of mathematics, how are they really different? And in the course of this talk, I'll ask you the same questions. What are the differences? So some of the discussion will be part of the talk. I'll make breaks and ask you questions and ask you to answer in the chat, which I have here on my right side and which I will follow. And so that is what I'll do. I love explaining stuff. That's the thing that has been my professional life for the last about 30 years. I started studying mathematics in 1990. And 2 years after, I had my first job as a teaching assistant. Teaching mathematics, and that is more or less what I've done ever since at high schools and at the university, and now at the Science Talenter. And besides mathematics, my other subjects is philosophy and physics. And the Science Talenter is a special organization that I guess is special to Denmark, and it's a place where we collect interested pupils from all over the country for camps, 3 days at a time, where they sleep and they eat together, and then they get taught from 9 morning to 9 evening. Usually it's themed camps. I do the mathematics themes, and I have colleagues doing physics, chemistry, biology, technology, and what have you. So I am very fortunate in that I only teach gifted and kids that are curious about science and also mathematics. At least that is why their teachers pick them out. Fortunately, I can't make long sequences of teaching. I only have them for 3 days. So that is the context in which I teach. And I said that I mainly teach at mathematics camps. That is not entirely true. We also have a mixed camp, and where the kids presented for a bit of physics, a bit of chemistry, a bit of math, a bit of technology. And the investigation, this talk is about was sparked by my experience that at these broad camps for kids with a broad interest in science and technology, there were still kids that really didn't like competition math. I had a workshop of an hour and a half on 24 hours of science camp, where I presented competition math. That is the meaning of the, it says here the Geomor workshop. Geomor is the name of the Danish competition math competition. I'll return to this shortly. And these kids, bright kids, smart kids of grade 8, of those, there were some that loved the competition math, but there were also surprisingly 7.2% that really didn't like it at all. And this is especially surprising since that we never get a rate 2 in any workshops at all in our camps otherwise. It's very, very rare that we get anything less than a 3, which means so-so. So that got me thinking, these hand-picked clever kids, they don't like competition maths, but they are probably good in school. As I said, the teachers pick them out, and they only are allowed to send one or two from each year. They wouldn't pick out kids unless they were really sure, and it would be very rare to excel in physics or chemistry at school, but be bad at math. So they, my assumption is that they would still be good at the math that they meet in schools. And this is where I explain the Gilmore competition. We already heard about the Mathematics Olympiad, and we heard about the German mini-step road to the Mathematical Olympiad. And in Denmark, we have a 2 rounds competition that takes a smaller and smaller population of kids that will end out with 6 students going to the Baltic Way, for instance. And the Geomor competition is part of this. And though the Baltic Way, the Olympiad, is for high school, you can enter at least the first round of the Geomor competition while you are 13 or 14 years of age. This is like the German problems for mathematical contests. The problems are all online, so as a teacher, you can go and find problems there and show your kids. And that's what I do when I have to do a 90-minute introduction to interesting and hard mathematics. So. I wanted to find out why and how it would be possible for a bright eighth grade pupil to be good at and like ordinary school math, but not like the competition math and the competition problems. And I did this in the context of a camp, of course, a 2-day camp, November last year, where the purpose of the camp was preparing kids to enter the Geomor competition. But most of these kids had never encountered Geomor problems before this camp, so I needed to introduce the problems to them, and I wanted to do it by showing the similarities between what they are ordinarily taught in the schools and the Geomor problems. So I had these 24 pupils aged 14 to 16, and the very first activity in the camp was showing them 2 sets of problems. And the one was the one they knew. It would be the school test. It would be the exam that you attend after finishing secondary school. And the other one would be a set of problems from the first round of the Gilmore. And I pointed out to the kids that of course there would be a great shared ground of sorts of subjects that are covered in the two problem sets, and that would be, for instance, equations and geometry and measurement, reduction and algebra, parentheses and science, probability and statistics. These subjects are all part of both sets of problems. So what are the differences? And now I'll turn, now I'll show you three or four examples of these problems, and we'll discuss what are the differences and what are the similarities. So let's start out in, and right here. I don't know to which extent the Danish school mathematics is similar to the German or Serbian or Israeli or other countries, but I guess I think that the ways that the school math that competition math is an extra sort of that demands something extra that might be the same. So I hope it's relevant in your countries too. Yes, but let's start looking at the meat of the presentation, the problems. Here you see one of the early problems from the school test set, problem number 7, and from the Gilmore competition set, problem number 1. And the school test is in marked in blue and the Gilmore in red. And now I'll be quiet for a minute and ask you to describe in the chat or to raise your hand if you want to explain in verbally. What do you notice are differences between and similarities between the two problems on the screen? And the minute is up, and I see that Dennis answers there's no need to mathematize the information in the school test. And that's one of the points I noticed myself too. And also Carl Henning earlier today said that the idea of having to translate text into an equation was typically a part of, was something that could be a part of competition math, but not too often in ordinary math. Yes, and Judy Mills and Klaus Henning are saying, have points similar to this, the need to translate from words into an equation before you get to solve it. That is similar to what I've written here. The Guillaume-Moore problem is a word problem. It doesn't say of itself, I'm an equation that you need to solve. That's one thing where it's very clear in the school test that it comes under a heading at the top of the page where the problem is given. It says numbers and algebra. So the kids know this is what I have to do. And it's written with plus and x and equals. And it's even told that the answer will be x equals something that you have to write. What else have I written? Another thing, there's two tasks to do the Guillaume-Moore problem. The one is to turn it into an equation. The other is to make a decision as to what should x mean, because the information we're given is about Wednesday tomorrow, but the question is about Tuesday today. So there's also a step of solving another problem that will give you the information you need to solve the real problem, the problem that is asked for. And as I, it was sense that this would also be the case for German competition problems, that there's this words that needs to be translated as a typical feature of a competition problem. So let's move to another shared subject. Geometry and measurement. Here again, from the same two sets, there's a school test, the examination from the 2018. There's geometry problem about measuring, calculating the a metal edge along a table, the red line, how long is it? And there's a Guillaume-Moore problem from the same set that also concerns a diagram, a figure drawing, and asks this time for an area. I'll give you a minute, and then we'll discuss similarities and dissimilarities. So the minute is up and this chat is quiet. Let me see if the same you're making the same points at me. Dennis says the red problem, the Guillaume-Moore problem, is using variables and not numbers. And it's more complex shape. Karl Hoyer has the same point, or Duty comments on it's a multiple choice problem. Like you're more one with five possible answers, and they have of course tried to find answers that you would make if you made a mistake. And this, as I'm sure you all know, that's the real difficult thing about making multiple choice problems, is make plausible wrong answers. Alexandra Mihailovic says that the school test requires applications of formula, while the GM task requires high order thinking, needing to identify given data and find a way to put them in relation to calculate the requested area. And they use numbers in the school test and symbols in the GM test. And that is, of course, more or less what I have written beforehand. And I, in short form, a similarity is that here very, a good part of the Gilmore problems are pure abstract mathematics, but this is one of the earlier ones, so they've done what is also commonly done in school tests, imagined a situation, a practical situation, like a kid not wanting to shower, in order to make it plausible that you would want to answer this question. And as you all said, there's numbers versus symbols. And I think something along what Alexandra notices, there's a higher order of thinking in the Gilmore problem, because what you can calculate is the white path of the picture, but what you asked for is a gray path. So another example of needing deeper analysis, needing to dig out some information that is not directly given in the text, but that you will have to work to figure out for yourself before you can employ it in order to solve the question and give the correct answer. Yes. And I'll show you a third one. There's lots more. This one comes on under the heading of reduction and algebra. The school test is a multiple choice problem that asks the kids to rewrite the area of a triangle in order to isolate the h, which is the height. Whereas the Gilmore is also algebra, but this time it's inequalities. And just as before, I'll give you a minute to comment on similarities and dissimilarities. Yes, and that was the minute that was up. And I have Dennis saying that in the school test, then you are the kids are reminded of the formula for the area of a triangle, and that is this reduction, this rewriting of a formula is not any formula. It's a formula they will have seen hundreds of times, and they might even have made this rewriting to isolate the H before. So they could solve it from scratch using rules of manipulations, but they could also remember the answer. It's recognizable. It's the formula itself is not new. But the Guillemot, I guess there would be almost 100% guarantee that they have never considered precisely 2 times x bigger than 3 times y bigger than 4 times z. And also, it's about inequalities, which is new, which is not taught in secondary level in Denmark. Also, this is normally for very much for high school students, but it's one of a few area where the subject matter would be new to an eighth grader. But as Klaus Henning notes, you could draw the different situations on a number line and use that to get an idea of the answer. This is my interpretation of a heuristic approach that would be, even though you're not used to manipulating inequalities, you could use drawings or explorations, examples. Yes, so this was three examples of setting up problems with the same subject in the same mathematical subdiscipline up next to each other, and to look after similarities and dissimilarities. As I said, I used it to the kids to say, you don't need to be scared, you know this. You've been in school for years and years, and you know this stuff. But I also asked them what was different. Oh, I am skipping something I wanted to say. Namely that there are also subjects which are not common ground to the two sets of tests of problems. Most of what is in the school tests are also in the Guillemot, and most of what is in Guillemot is also in the school tests, but there are things that are not shared between them. Only arithmetics, plus and minus and equals and multiplication, is considered a prerequisite to do the Guillemot test. It's not tested as such, but it is in the examination test sets. And the reason I asked earlier about how would logic and game theory look for a fifth grader in Germany was in part because these subjects are new and different to secondary level schools in pupils in Denmark, but they do occur in the Guillemot test. Because as we also heard when we heard about the Olympiad mathematics, they are easy to make into short, readily understandable problems with precise answers, just as I like. Yes, so what do the kids say when we ask them? My colleague Sina and I, we presented these sets of problems to them. We had them trying to solve them and discuss them. And afterwards we said, what did you think about the Guillemot problems, and what? How are they different? And what the kids said was, as you also noted, there's a lot of text. Having problems with no diagrams or no mathematical symbolism at all, which would also be in some of the probability or the game theory problems. That's completely new to them. And of course, using letters instead of numbers is new. But also, they call it, you have to think logically. You have to use logical thinking, which I think is their way of saying something like, you have to analyze the problem. You have to figure out additional information to the one that is explicitly given in the text. And also, and that was what they said the most, it was, oh, it's not like ordinary mathematics, the answers make sense, which I think means that if you have a question about the length of a table and the answer is 17 or 18, you get to know what the answer is, you get to know that the answer is correct. But in these Gilmour problems, you usually also get a sort of insight that it couldn't be any other way. It's not random. It has to be this way of they get the final answer is like the happy ending of a narrative that closes it all together and ties it up in a tidy bow. And also, and they were much taken with this. And also, you have to get an idea. It's not enough to know the formulas. It's not enough to have a standard method and to do what you always do. You have to see the problems in a certain way. You have to, get a new idea and a certain way to look at it. So that was the kids' reactions. I have already in the course of showing you the examples told you what Sina and I talked about were the differences, but I would sum it up as there's a certain mathematical language that also Fesanolde pointed to. It takes time to learn a given X, then it can be deducted that is a prime, is a composite. So there are mathematical idioms that are not in their ordinary school mathematics. Then there's a complexity of the problems where you have to analyze the problem in order to and work with it a bit to get the answer. And then there's the need to get ideas in order to be able to find the answer. So, this I have of course omitted examples and so on, but I'll leave it here in order to keep place for discussion. If you have questions or reactions or comparisons to your own countries or what it might be. So thank you for your attention.